there are the practical ways that how FPGAs and programmable chips implement the computational logic.
Okay.
So, if you recollect, you know how the combinational logic Boolean expression actually we have seen that the combinational logic can be described through you have a product of some term or sum of product term. So to realize product terms, you need AND gate. To realize actually some terms, you need OR gates. So we can actually use a combination of AND and OR with some programmability built into them to realize actually combinational logic. That's what we are going to see now, using some kind of ROMs, some kind of programmable gate arrays, etc. So ROM. So ROM is the ROM way of implementing is it can be easily visualized. How a ROM can implement it. How a ROM can implement actually the combination logic function. So first of all, what is a ROM like? You know, traditionally the ROM means you write once only and then onwards you read. But a ROM can be two types of ROMs. Like one-time programmable ROM means it is strictly one-time programmable. Okay, in the sense you program once, that's it. There is no way that actually you can alter the content. So they are actually one-time programmable ROMs. But all ROMs which are actually a non-volatile type need not be only one-time programmable. They can be, you can also have actually a ROM which is programmable for more than one time.
Got it.
So, usually when we are talking in the context of FPGAs and all, we are not talking about one-time programmable ROMs. One-time programmable, what kind of technology will be involved in one-time programmable ROMs? Usually, whatever this fuse and anti-fuse kind of technologies, they will go into one-time programmable. And that is basically the final stage of some small design where you don't have to modify anything, and by making it one-time programmable, its life will be more, or some other reason is there, then only it will go for one-time programmable. Otherwise, you have basically non-volatile, reprogrammable ROMs. So they are non-volatile, means once you program, the content will be there. Even if you remove the power, the content will be there. But if you want to reprogram, it is possible. So usually those kind of ROMs we call as PROMs, programmable read-only memory. If you look into history of our digital logic implementation and all, during 1970s and all, where three popular architectures people treated as programmable circuits, implementation, digital circuits implementation. One is PROM, other one is PLA, and third one is PAL. An in-depth of analyzing these things, we will have in the subsequent module where we are talking about the FPGA and history and all. But since for the sake of understanding that how a combinational logic circuit can be implemented through ROM, we are discussing in this context. So anyhow, now what actually you mean ROM can be, like once you program, you read at will, whenever you want you read it, okay? Then essentially it's a kind of lookup table. Okay, now if I go back to the next slide, I can explain. So you have total four inputs to the ROM. So four inputs in the sense, there are 16 possible locations. And the present ROM is implementing 4-bit output. See, it is not compulsory that 4-bit input will have 4-bit output. Need not be. 4-bit input can have 4-bit output, 1-bit output, 8-bit output, anything. It is something like you have a full adder is there. Three inputs are there. Two outputs are there. So depending upon the logic that you are implementing, the number of input output can be different. When we are using ROM, for the purpose of implementing combinational Boolean functions, whatever inputs of your Boolean function, they will be fed to the ROM inputs, address lines. If let us say you have more, then you can feed zeros to them. Okay? And whatever Boolean function output you want, that will be achieved by putting the appropriate content into the ROM. See, ROM idea is what, these are 64-bit ROM. How 64-bit? There are 16 locations, because 4-bit address means 16 words. And each word is 4-bit, so 64 locations. Out of them, your interest is to implement only one Boolean function, let us say, that is F. That you want to program it onto D0. Okay? Then D1, D2, D3 will have some values, which we don't know. So we are referring it as X. So that D0, exactly whatever you want F, you store that when you program it. So whenever you want to find out the Boolean function, feed X, Y, Z, F will come out on D0. That's how we implement it. It's a very simple principle. Now, this is a further continuation of it. So, anyhow, I am going to explain about what is PLA, PAL in the next slide. So, I will skip this English writer. It's for you to read later. So, now this is actually a simple way of looking at implementing some sum of product expression. So sum of products. So when you talk about actually sum of products, you know that first you are going to realize the product terms, then you are going to realize the sum terms. So these are the product terms, the end plane which you have to realize actually product terms. And those product terms, once you compute them, you will find sum of them. So that's what I mean by sum of products. So obviously one can guess. So if you want to make out basically product of sum, so product terms will be, sum terms will come first. So means right from the input literals, so we use actually one word which is formal word in digital circuit theory, that a literal. So A is a literal, A bar is a literal, B is a literal, B bar is a literal. So total, that from literals, first you will have R planes, I mean R gates, then you will have end. So now let us look at here, what are the permutations and combinations you can have. A PROM is simply, you have actually fixed end plane and programmable R plane.
Yes.
PROM, okay, is a fixed end plane. What is the fixed end plane? See, this end gate is going to have permanent connection to over here. Got it? So usually, when we have PROM, fixed end plane, each end term would realize basically one, what is called min term. So recollect our usage of min term, max term. A three variable Boolean function is there, A, B, C. So A bar, B bar, C bar, A bar, B bar, C. Each one is like a min term. Like that, how many min terms will be there in a three Boolean variable function? 8. So there will be 8 end gates because all min terms are there. Now, wherever this R plane is there, there will be a program gate. Actually, this diagram is not written to that. Okay? So in case of if it is a PROM, this line, here also there will be a fuse, here also there will be a fuse, here also there will be a fuse. Let's say you want to pick this main term, then these two fuses will be blown and this fuse only will be kept. So like that each line will have actually one this one here. Maybe if I should, I can quickly draw and show you. I will go for a case of simple two variable. I am now discussing about actually PROM, okay, programmable read only memory. So I have A, A bar, then I have B and B bar. So what I said, fixed end plane. So in case of fixed end plane, 1, 2, 3, 4, because I know it will be only 4 minterms. So first one is going to be what? A bar and B bar. Next one is, these are permanent connections, not programmable connections. So that's what in PROM we talk about fixed end plane. In PROM. Okay. Now 1, 2, 3, 4 outputs will be there. So next one will be what? If I assume, I mean if I go by convention of A is the left hand side, okay, MSB and B is LSB like that, then A bar B. So this A bar is here and B is here. The next A B bar. So A is here, B bar is here. Next A B. So A is here and B is here. These are permanent connections. Permanent, so it's a fixed. Now these are the end terms. So like there can be any number of R gates. Okay? So these are all fuses. So what I am showing is actually a general architecture, a specific chip number. If you look into, there will be some, architecture where they will say there will be 4 R terms or 5 R terms or 10 R terms like that. Okay. So now, this is what. So what this fellow is actually giving, any Boolean function which is implementable with a combination of these main terms, you can use. Got it? So let us say you want to take, you want to take this. Then you can blow these three fuses. Like this, you may have another R. You may have another R. In short, one can represent even by like this also. Yes. Okay? So this could be one notation. So now this is what you mean by actually PROM. Now variants of this you can visualize. If you have, let us say, this is fixed and this is actually programmable. Okay? If you have reverse, then it is called actually PAL. Okay? Programmable array logic. You have both programmable, then it is called programmable logic array. You got it? So the summary goes like this. So if you have, in the context of, this is actually what end plane and this is R plane. In case of PROM, this is fixed and this is programmable. In case of PAL, it is reverse. This is programmable and this is fixed. In case of PLA, both are programmable. Anyhow, these are architectural variants. Out of them, not many chips came out in the market and people used with PAL variant, okay, programmable array logic variant. Anyway, there are even chips with PROM also and PLA also. But But we talk about this in subsequent when we talk about CPLD and FPGA architectures, because an extension of these, okay, was called as SPLD, and later further extension of this was called CPLD. All that we will study later. For our immediate focus, we want to just appreciate the fact that you can realize the combinational Boolean function by this kind of architectures also. That's what only we want to now concentrate. Okay, there are other variants also possible. You can have a lot of types of ROMs are possible, flash, fuse, anti-fuse, lot of things are there. Then you can also have a SRAM kind of, if you look into FPGA. Yeah.
But as we know that in PROM and PLA, there is some variation between AND and OR.
Right.
Then why we are going for PLA, sir, for programming both AND and OR?
No, I mean, this is even more, it is more customization. See, when you talk about PROM, when this is fixed and this is programmable, see, all these three, how they become contextual is, this is something, let's say, you know, you are able to realize four minterms. When you say end gate is fixed, means you are able to, the principle like, you have to realize all minterms, and any function, F1, F2 or F3, when you want to realize, it would be actually a selected combination of it would be a selected combination of these kind of, you know, midterms. So now their question comes, like, you want to represent, you have three this kind of things, four this kind of things, five this kind of things, you got it there. So in for certain class of Boolean functions, having PLA becomes more useful. For certain class of Boolean functions, having PROM becomes more efficient in the sense. See, when
we
it comes
might,
to
we might have a Boolean expression either in term of SOP or POS.
No, that is not the question. See, you can rewrite the Boolean function from SOP to POS, PO to SOP. The choice of actually using PROM or PLA or PAL is not based on actually the because the Boolean function is POS and go. It's not like that. All these three are written for basically SOP only. Even though I say programmable array logic, where end gate is programmable, OR gate is fixed, first gate will be end gate only.
Yes.
It is not the other way. You got it? So intention here is, either you want to basically first visualize your Boolean functions as selection of minterms, or even you want to give programmability in actually selecting a minterm itself. You got it? In certain places, these fellows find more useful. But what happens is, you know, these fellows have architecture wise limitation, you know, scalar, they cannot scale. Like, for example, now you are able to do it because there are only two Boolean functions. If you have, let us say, four Boolean functions, you have to come out with the 16 this kind of things.
Yes.
If you have 8, then you have to go to 256. But however, in 256 minterms, no output is actually selecting, you know, to 200 Boolean functions at all. Means 200 minterms are not at all being used by any R term. Just no use. So when it comes to in principle, anything can be used for realizing Boolean function. But there are some limitations in terms of going by PROM, because as the Boolean functions become more and more Boolean variables get involved, completely scaling up to give 2 power n minterms is not going to be, you know, kind of efficient architecture. Now you may ask, what is the efficiency? See, when you are talking about realizing a Boolean function by using some programmable logic, you will reserve basically a programmable logic like cell, like PLA cell or PAL cell. Whatever the maximum possible or the worst case Boolean function, having so many combinations, if you design your PLA architecture for that, when you are realizing simple Boolean functions, this is actually an inefficient. Or will you be able to realize multiple Boolean functions in the same plane? See, it may so happen, depending on architecture, each OR gate may be able to realize one Boolean function. But if the number of uses that you give option to each OR gate are less in number, then you may have to get one Boolean function F only, half from here and half from here, and again get one more OR gate which is output of it. You understand? So there are different variants that people have worked out. And the main problem comes when you talk about bigger Boolean functions. So people have found that this is not probably the way that, you know, you work with, because just the number of minterms you want to achieve in end gate, then you try to sum up them. That is going to be little, you know, okay with the smaller Boolean function, but not larger. So that's why you don't find a 14 input and 8 input kind of thing in PROM. Okay? when you go to the 14 port, 18 input and all these, even today they are available, programmable array logic chips, they are all PAL, programmable array logic. Lot of chip numbers also start with PAL and PAL and all. So I am trying to tell you that, don't think these are actually sum of product or product of some variance, no. All these are actually implementable from your sum of product expression only. First you will have N, then you will have R. That is what actually the style followed in this. But that end whatever you have first, is it fixed or programmable? All what you have is fixed or programmable? Is that way? You got it? Both programmable is a very ideal. Because if both programmable is there, given less number of N and less number of R, I will realize a Boolean function. Why? See, let's say for example, I have something like Y is equal to AB bar BC, something like this. If both programmable is there, simply I will take this NDA, first NDA. A, B bar, wherever both programmable means what I have fuse here.
Yes.
To realize A, B bar, wherever I need to keep fuse, wherever I need to blow, I blow. Simple for me. So this straightforward I achieve by one term. This straightforward I achieve by one term. So I can just take a R of it and get it. So having PLA is the most ideal, but that calls for a cost. So there is a compromise there. So people have tried this one. Okay? That's good. Anyhow, this calls for altogether a different kind of theory if we have to get into the kind of giving effectiveness of a programmable architecture to realize the general Boolean function. There exists always a trade-off. When you aim for very worst case Boolean functions, then when you are implementing smaller Boolean functions, lot of area will be useless. In the sense, the area will be there, but you won't be able to use it. In the sense, see, let's say you have NDGate. And this is assumed, this is 8 variables are. So 16 such literals will come. 16 fuses are there. You got it? But let's say all Boolean functions that you are implementing are only having 2 literals like this. Then it's a kind of, what we are trying to say, effectiveness is lost. So that is altogether a different theory to describe about when you have a programmable logic, how effectively you are able to realize Boolean functions. However, just a basic understanding if we get, that is good enough in a VLSI designer point of view. Got it there. But when you talk about FPGA cell designer point of view, and there are some subjects of our research subjects, of our FPGAs and other things, reconfigurable designs, there all these issues will come. How efficiently you are able to design a reconfigurable cell or FPGA cell so that it can give capability of realizing the variety of Boolean functions. At the same time, it takes lesser area, lesser hardware. Anyhow, our understanding here is to get a feel that what is the basic architecture principle in them. You got it? You get good number of diagrams on web for one chip. I forgot the number, GAL, some number will be there, V22, V10, something like that. Okay, it's internal architecture and all. And so many M.Tech courses also, they take that particular chip as a case study. And one of the chapters describes what is inside there. Point is that it is actually PAL, programmable array logic. Okay? Maybe in that particular session where I am talking about the FPGA, CPT architectures, I guess I have a slide which is going inside of PL and explaining that. Okay.
Now these all we will talk later. These are related to other memory. Even though if you look into that today's FPGA now, we are going by the concept of ROM programming only, that is lookup table, ROM only, but that is not actually what is called non-volatile type, that is volatile type one. But functionality will be same, like FPGA, it is SRAM, that's what we are talking about, SRAM. An SRAM, which is a memory only, is used to realize basically a Boolean function. So when you power on and program your FPGA bit 5, the lookup tables hold the combinational Boolean functions. You got it? But once you remove the power, content is lost. It's okay. As long as whether it is a principle of PROM, okay, non-volatile type, or using SRAM volatile type, the principle of using a memory to realize the Boolean function is very, very simple. So I want to ask one question here and see how much you are able to grasp this principle. Let's say you have a Boolean function, 5 input Boolean function.
What is it? F is equivalent to, let me just call Y is equivalent to function of A, B, C, D, E. All are these Boolean functions. Okay? And I have, let me erase this part, I have a 4 input lookup table. I have a simple 4-input lookup table. This is a 4-input lookup table. Since it is 4-input, I can say A3, A2, A1, A0. A typical SPARON 3 FPGA drives, if you see, you will have this architecture. And let's assume this is a Y. So now,
These are all the cells that I have. I have one 4 input lookup table, another 4, like that I have so many, thousands, you know, this one. So how this will be realized? It is quite possible that you can have Boolean functions of more than 4 also. And you want to use this memory only. Then can you make any guess?
2 memories.
That's it. That's it. See, after all, this is able to give actually 16 by 1 configuration. This is able to give a 16 by 1 configuration. You need actually 32 by 1 configuration because 32 possible combinations are there, and out of 32 combinations, what happens to one Boolean function you have to describe. So you need a 32 by 1 ROM. So by using them, you will get it. Maybe what you can do is this A, when A is equal to 0, this output will be selected. When A is equal to 1, this output will be selected. Rest of all B, C, D, E are given to both the blocks. You got it? So, I mean, in a lookup, in a truth table kind of thing, if this fellow is realizing the first 16, you know, first 16 combinations in truth table, then next 16 are actually realized by this. That's how it happens. So I can probably leave a pointer here to one of the assignments once we start actually FPGA synthesis part, that you take up an example like this, just write a simple VHDL code or a Verilog code, take A, B, C, D as STD underscore logic or actually any reg type 1 meter. Then write some Boolean function, but see that all 5 are, you know, used in that expression. Something like y is equal to a bar b plus c d bar e, something like that. Synthesize and see what happens. You will notice, once you look into the floor plan of FPGA after synthesis, you will notice the two lookup tables are used.
Sir, means after writing visual code, can you see this type of architecture in the...
Yeah. That's what we will be doing in our next module. After writing the code, when we start learning about synthesis, okay, when we choose SPADA 3 FPGA, inside the SPADA 3 FPGA, a slice will have two lookup tables like this, each of 4 bit. Okay? We will write the code, write a very VHDL code for this, or you can write Verilog also, synthesize that, and we open actually FPGA floor plan and see inside that, and see how the Boolean function is implemented. We'll be able to do that. Okay? That's what I'm saying. I'm leaving a pointer from here that you should do an exercise there, okay, once we learn this. Okay, now this slide is explaining about actually the, I mean, other purposes of a memory that we will not discuss now. We know about that. Okay. Now this is an important thing. Like I guess I might have covered this topic in some other this one. Did I discuss about the purpose of tri-state logic and all? Okay. Then okay. May not be for this batch. Maybe for some other batch, you know, I discussed it. Okay. Now point is like in digital, you know that. Logic 1 and logic 0 are represented by two voltage levels. How about two gates output is shorted? Where? Got it. Whether it is going to be any meaningful shock or it is going to cause any danger, like or it is not going to be a danger, but it won't give any meaningful output. Okay, it is some nonsense, like in the sense that maybe 1, that maybe 0 depend on other kind. There are these three are possibilities. First possibility is what? This kind of thing, like you know, that is actually a valid logic doing this. I'm not discussing about it because today in VLSI it is not a practice which is people do. It's my knowledge. Maybe there will be some extremes of VLSI where people are still using it, but it is not a standard design practice. So what are these? I mean, connecting two outputs and it is also giving a meaningful functionality is there. It is one of the design styles that people do in some logic families. Remember what are logic families? We discussed RTL, TTL, TTL, okay? So, I will just give you pointers if you want to read later. So, this is actually called wired AND and wired OR. Means, there are some techniques by which two gate outputs you short and take one output that gives an effect of as if there is an OR gate implemented with that connection. That's what you mean wired OR. Okay? So, it is not a usual design practice. So, we will not do this. Okay? There is, at least you take FPGAs and standard ASIC synthesis and all, this is not a supported style. Point number one. Point two, the second possibility is what? It is basically an invalid thing. But this invalid thing can lead to two possibilities. One, there is an electrical damage. By connecting this, you can expect an electrical damage to be there, but there is no string damage, but it's of meaningless. You got it? So that's what you mean invalid. So what is electrical damage? See, you are basically connecting the logic. Let's assume this is logic 1 which corresponds to 1.2 volts. this is actually logic 0, which is 0 volt. And maybe the resistance of this path, let us say it is some 0.5 ohm, something like that. Then you can expect 3.6 amperes of current will come. If 3.6 ampere comes in a VLSI chip, definitely it is going to burn out. But the point is, these devices itself are designed to have some amount of maximum current. Beyond that, they may not be able to provide the current. So that is not the only condition which decides whether there will be some damage or there is no damage. But point is, that is not a valid condition. So this is what usually, you know, we talk in the context of bus contention. Got it? In FPGAs are usually when the synthesis tools in which this is not allowed, this kind of connection is not allowed, you get actually either an error or a warning. With my knowledge, is an error. What is, let's say if it is a VHDL code, you know, it shows that multiple signal connections to the same signal. We will also do that as one of our design exercise in VHDL module. We will write a code in such a way that we will write two expressions to come on the same signal. Okay? How? Very simple. Write y is equivalent to
one
a and b, and also write y is equivalent to c and e.
C and
it will give an error. Okay, these two are concurrent statements. So it will give an error. And what error will say that multiple signal assignments are y, which is not synthesizable like that. You got it? But you may ask, why are you worried? If it is a mistake, then don't do it. Isn't it? But I am telling you, it is not a mistake. It is a requirement at so many places. It is
but
actually...
How it is valid here, sir? Valid and valid out?
Then if you want to get into, you should look into basically that circuit level place. There are some logic families where you can have a wired or wired connection. After all, see, we were discussing that day regarding pull up and pull down some configuration like that, right? So there are some gates where, you know, that flexibility will be left to you, so that by shorting them, okay, R combination or NOR combination, something can come. So it is scope of our current discussion, I am not discussing. I suggest you to do some web reading on this, you will be able to understand. Because we have some general discussion about TTL logic family and CMOS and all. With that knowledge, you will be able to understand. If not, you come back, we will discuss about that. Okay? So, yeah, what I am trying to say, if it is a kind of mistake in the design, then why are we worried about it? But it is not actually kind of all the time mistake. It's a design requirement. It's a design requirement in most of the cases. What do you mean? See, you know very well that when you have a microprocessor or microcontroller sort of thing, you know that it's a data bus. Okay? There will be only one data bus. There will be only 8 bits. Let's say if you talk about 8-bit microcontroller which is having 8-bit data bus, there will be only one set of 8 lines. But the same lines need to go to maybe keyboard, isn't it? Same may need to go to maybe hex keypad, okay? And same may need to go to some printer, may need to go to whatever it is. That's it. So it means a parallel connection only,
yes.
Isn't it? And out of them, the keyboard is an output device towards this. Hex keypad is also an output device. So it means two outputs you are shorting. Got it? So this is a design requirement, okay? So how do you manage this?
Here, the keyboard will be giving as an input for the microprocessor or microcontroller, whereas this printer will be acting as an output device.
For printer, you
data,
will be giving input.
Data will be coming out, data will be moving inside here.
Right, okay, correct. See, usually the word input output we speak it with respect to our processor, your point is right. Keyboard and X keypad should be considered input, whereas printer is output. But whatever, with respect to these two, they are output lines. Keyboard output line, X keypad output line. They are your shorting, right? That is the problem. It's a problem. Okay, unless you short them, you cannot hook up to the data bus of this one because you have only one set of data bus pins. So it's a design requirement. The solution is actually use tri-state buffers. Use tri-state buffers. So there is an alternative solution is you can also use actually, you know, control signals. In fact, people usually do in combination. They use tri-state buffers and they use control signals. That's how you get it. What it means, see, what is tri-state buffer? We are going to again discuss this topic in two levels, one now and one when we are discussing about module 5, ASIC module, where we discuss about the cells and all. So we will go in depth there how tri-state buffer being realized and how indirectly the concept of floating gate comes, you know, in transmission gate CMOS logic family, all that we will discuss later. For time being, to just understand what is tri-state buffer, take a simple CMOS inverter. Okay, in this you cannot realize tri-state. I am just trying to first of all create a context where I can explain about what is low impedance and what is high impedance. Tri-state is nothing but actually high impedance state. Okay. So this is VDD and this is actually input and this is output. So for one combination of input, let us say 0, then you know there is a short circuit exists like this. So output is actually going to VDD. This path, whatever this path is there, which is of smaller impedance, so it's a low impedance. Got it? Same, when you give 1, it takes this path. This path will not be there, but this path it will take. So now it is seen to ground, it is also a low impedance.
Low impedance.
Got it? Low impedance and high impedance. Low impedance in the sense, low impedance indirectly tells that the capability of more current sourcing are sinking. You got it? See, this is also low impedance point in circuit, this is also low impedance point in circuit. Okay? Since it is low impedance point in circuit, it is able to drive more and more amount of current based on your requirement. Since it is a low impedance ground in your circuit, it is able to sink all the current to discharge your output capacitor. Got it? And these words are actually used in a very precise way, and they become design criteria in analog VLSA design. Because in analog VLSA, as we were discussing in the beginning days of this module, you are not just only concerned saying, okay, one command, one is going to all the design modules. It's not like that. Because you remember how we are able to live with an abstraction of 1 and 0. Maybe I can expect answer from you now. How you are able to say, okay, 1 means, okay, 1, AND gate 1 is driving, another 4 AND gates coming. That is under some electrical constraints being met. Isn't it? We know pretty well when 1 you are implementing, it could be anywhere between some 1.2 volts to 1.8 volts something. And as long as you are not loading more, I mean, you are keeping the load only less than fan out, and you are also fanning also is being considered. So under some electrical conditions, your digital gates is going to work ideally. Isn't it? In the sense, 1 will be 1 only, 0 will be 0 only and all. And when we go to our CMOS logic family and all, we will be talking about something called restoring logic and non-restoring logic. That is also one of the ideal conditions only. Just forget about now, I will explain that. So there are so many ideal conditions. As long as your digital circuits are working under those conditions, 1s and 0s are happily taken granted. But in analog, it's not like that. 1.8, if it goes to 1.7 also, in analog, it is a kind